is described in detail in the Geant4 installation guide, how to use cmake to build and compile Geant4 from its source code in a Linux machine.
I need to pass a lot of variables to cmake. And how are you gonna remember all of this? It's hard. You have to do a lot of typing. In case that you type something wrong, you will have to fix it. Sometimes the things that you type in wrong is so hard to find. So that's a problem for this particular approach. So how can we make it slightly simpler? We just need to add one more thing in front of cmake. That's another C. So you run ccmake. And that will make everything much simpler. This is my Linux machine. And I can go to a web browser. And then I can click on download to get the Linux tar format of source code of Geant4 and then save it to my hard disk. So I can see that the Geant4 is downloading and saved into my hard disk. And then I go to my terminal and I run a command called tar to unzip everything. And then let me see, now I should have it. Yes, now I have the Geant4 10.7 patch 1. I have a older version, slightly older version installed already. So let's just go to the patch 1 version. So what we're gonna do here is that we're gonna create a directory called build. The reason we create that one is because in the compilation or the building process, many things will be created. We would like to keep all of these things separated from the Geant4 source code. Otherwise, after a while, you cannot determine which file is automatically generated, which file is shipped originally from Geant4. So let's create the build directory. Take a look. We have the build directory here. So let's get into it. And there's nothing inside, of course, because we just made it. So now what we do is that we do ccmake instead of cmake. Okay, so we need to add a path to the source. So the path to the source is our parent directory. So we just add dot dot means the parent directory. Okay, now we have it. So you can see that ccmake provided us a command line user interface. Well, it's almost the same as a graphic user interface. You cannot click, but you have things that you can look at. You have a menu here, basically. At the very beginning, we have to configure the whole thing. So we just press C and see what will happen. Okay, so if you run this one, you don't have to remember all of this. This is pretty long. You just need to remember ccmake, that's it. Okay, so the configuration is done. And you can press E to exit it. But maybe we can take a look of what has been done. Okay. So you see that there is some basic information about how to run cmake, where if you really want to run it in a command line, you can use all of this. So all of here is about whether we need to download Geant4 data. Right. So these are some basic information and about your system as well, like my compiler version. So let's escape from here. You're gonna see all of this. Those are the parameters you need to set up based on your own preference. So you can go through individual ones and change them. Let's just take a look at a few important things. The cmake build type, in the previous Geant4 version, it lists a lot of different things, but really what you need is just one, that's release. Now it's fine, they just provided you one, just release, so you don't have to change this one. The cmake install prefix, that's the place where you want to install your Geant4. Normally, if you run a Linux machine, especially a remote Linux machine, you don't have the root privilege. You can't install it in user local directory. So this is something you will have to change. You need to change it to your own directory that you have the right to write to. So we need to change this one. You can see that press enter to confirm or press escape to cancel. And let's just type. We're gonna do home. This is my username. And I just installed it here. I installed into my home directory. If you want, you can create a directory called Geant4, 0.10, 0.7, 0.1, something like this. That's fine too. Build multi-threaded. For the multi-threading, I think if you use a single PC and you have many cores, I think you should turn it on. That's very, very helpful. If you use a remote Linux farm, you're going to use the batch system to provide you a lot of CPUs. In that case, you probably don't need to have the multi-thread enabled. Install data, I normally just turn it on because I don't want to install data by myself one by one. There's a lot of data files here. So if you want to download them one by one, it takes a lot of time. So I would recommend you to directly use the provided interface to download them automatically for you. Okay, so the installation data directory will go together with the prefix. Once you set up the prefix, you don't have to worry about this anymore. Okay, GDML, do you need to turn it on? If you turn it on, you will have to install something else. It relies on a third-party library. To make it simple, we don't turn it on. Qt is something really, really nice. The graphic user interface based on Qt is really eye candy. But again, it relies on the third-party libraries. I do not turn it on this time. I'm going to talk about this one later on, how necessary it is for you to have a graphic user interface to run your Geant4 simulation. That's basically it. There are not too many things that you need to tune. So once you finish this configuration, you just press C again to configure it again. It looks like we need to press C again, because once you finish everything, you can see another button here. Let me try this one again. Yes, so you press it a few times until you see generate. Now I press G to generate those files. Okay, ccmake quit by itself already. Now if you press LS, you see that we already have a lot of things created here. So next thing you need to do is just type make. And if you have multiple cores, you add minus J to use all the cores, but maybe not all of them. So maybe you use only 8 of them. Let me check how many cores are there in this machine. Cat process CPU. So we have 8 cores. So from 0 to 7, so that's 8 cores. So if I use all of them, maybe other people cannot run things anymore. So let me just use 4 cores instead. Okay, so at the very beginning, it's not a compilation process. It is simply just downloading process to download all the data files. And once that is done, you can see that from time to time, you can see that there is some building process going on there. So different cores are doing different things and their output mix up in this terminal. Now I think the downloading has finished. So now you can see it's only not compilation. It's only 4%, 5%. It takes a long time to finish the whole process. After you finish your making process, you do make install and you're gonna install it. So this would be the end of the installation process. However, if you go to the official Geant4 installation guide, there is a post-installation setup that is very, very important. The first thing we would like to understand is the structure of the installed Geant4. There is only 4 directories, bin or binary directory, include, lib, and share, and that's it. Let's go to the place where I just installed Geant4. So let me go here. In my ccmake interface, I set the cmake install prefix to my home directory. So let's just go to my home directory and take a look. So we have the bin, we have include, we have lib64, and then we have share. In the bin directory, for a Unix or Linux machine, you only have 3 files, geant4/config, geant4.c shell, and geant4.sh. sh. This one is only for Windows. So let's take a look. Yeah, so indeed we have this three files in the bin directory. I'm gonna use another interface, it's easier for me. So if we go to the include, you can see the Geant4, and inside you have all the HH files, the header files. So include all the header files. The reason you need this one is because when you compile your Geant4 main program, you need to know the declaration of all the functions in Geant4 or classes in Geant4. That's why you need this thing. In lib64, I installed two Geant4 versions. So if you go to the one that we just installed, you can see that .so file, that's a shared object or shared libraries. And the other one that is important is all the .cmake files. And so we're gonna mention this one later on. This is very, very important. If we go to share, we see that there is a directory for each Geant4 version installed in my system. Let's go to the newest one. We have the data that is automatically installed. And then we have examples. That is the basic structure of Geant4 installation. And then you need to set up some environment variables on your machine so that your operating system can find everything about your Geant4. So the easiest way is to source geant4.sh file that is in your bin directory. We'd like to take a look at the contents of that file and see what is set there. Okay, so if we open the sh file, so first of all, it's just check the shell version. Make sure that you're using the right one. And then it adds the Geant4 binding directory into your path so that the Geant4 config can be found by your system. And then it declares the LD library path. That is important when you run your own Geant4 application, that is the main program. It will call all the shared libraries provided by Geant4 that the system needs to know where to find those shared libraries. So this LD library path is a way for you to tell your system where to find your Geant4 libraries. And then the rest is about the location of your data sets. That's it. So we just source this file. That's the end of the post setup for Windows and the Mac. I have a few YouTube videos to describe it. So if you use those operating systems, you can check my YouTube videos.